Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and get us started, kick us off. So welcome. Welcome to the ninth episode, if you will, of CS Plus, the CS Plus webinar series that we've been doing with NCWIT. I'm Brittany Anderson Martin, and yeah, I'm your host today. I'm excited to have you with us. And if you are not aware, the National Center for Women in Information Technology is a nonprofit community. Basically, the mission is to convene, equip, and unite more than 1,500 change leader organizations to increase the meaningful and influential participation of all women and genderqueer non-binary individuals in the field of computing and technology. We also like to add on there that particularly in the space of innovation and development, because those are key aspects of this industry. So, oops, wrong way. This webinar series, the CS Plus series, is sponsored by DoD STEM, which is the largest employer of STEM people, STEM roles, STEM employees in the United States. DoD STEM provides learning opportunities from elementary school through graduate school to inspire and cultivate a diverse pool of exceptional STEM talent. NCWIT is a part of the DoD STEM DSEC, which is a consortium of nonprofits and other organizations, institutions, higher education, that are working to increase access and participation in STEM for people at every intersection and every space. And I just want to throw out a little reminder that we are doing an incentive for you being here. So first of all, thank you so much for coming and being on time. Now you have two ways to win $100. Be entered into a $100 random drawing. The first is to be here and participate. And that's all you got to do. And then we'll put you in the random drawing. And the second is after this event, you'll be sent an evaluation so that you can tell us how it went, what you thought. And we use those evaluations kind of to help us shape the programs that we do and offer at NCWIT. So please feel free to give us your full opinion. And for both of those actions, you will be entered into the drawing. Now, for the participation incentive, there are going to be two polls that I do have to launch. They're very easy, like yes or no, but that is the way that you technically are entering into the drawing. So make sure that you do participate in those polls when you see them pop up, and I'll let you know and give you a warning. And the first poll is going to be popping up right now. So the only question, one question, what brought you to today's webinar? Feel free to respond. I am not going to share the response, but as a reminder, this is the way that you are able to like enter the participation poll for being here. So you do have to respond in order to be entered into the drawing. And now with those little announcements, I am going to stop sharing, and we're going to kick off the conversation. So I'd like to say welcome to our speakers. Hi. Today we have Valencia Coleman and Ashley Chu, who will be sharing with us about their experiences in the gaming technology industry. So first, Ashley Chu is a software engineer at Datadog who recently graduated from UC Berkeley, where she studied electrical engineering, computer science, and art history. Welcome, Ashley. Do you want to say hi or add anything to the video?
Yeah, for sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Ashley. I'm excited to be here. I have mainly interned in games since I'm starting my first new grad role as a software engineer in an industry that isn't specifically games, but I started out working at WB Games and mobile games, and then I've also worked at a game startup called Dreamhaven, working on a game platform for other games. But I'll talk more about this later on, but in general, have always been interested in the entertainment and game space, also within Disney and animation and 3D graphics as a whole.
Thank you, Ashley. And then we also have Valencia Coleman. Valencia is an associate gameplay engineer at Alchemy Labs. That's, I like the way it's owl spelled, O-W-L. She graduated with her bachelor's degree in computer science and is currently pursuing an MFA in interactive media and game design. Hi, Valencia.
Hello, everyone. So yeah, I am actually no longer an associate anymore. I recently got promoted to grad gameplay engineer level one. So that is my new title at Alchemy Labs. And yeah, that's what I do. I spent my little backstory. I spent quite a few time getting the bachelor's degree in computer science. I did some IT work, but I always did games on the side. I have passion for video games, still have passion for video games. So now I make VR games with Alchemy Labs.
Perfect. Okay, so I'm excited to talk about that. But first, we're going to break the ice with a little icebreaker. So I like to call this game Hot Seat because I'm just going to ask y'all a bunch of random questions. We are going to alternate and we're going to learn a little bit more about you. So I'm going to set a 2-minute timer and we will start with Valencia. Okay. And we'll go. If you had to choose one song to play every time you entered a room, what would it be?
I actually just heard it. It's Who I Am by, I forgot the name of the artist, but it's Who I Am. And basically, I love that song because like, this is who I am, flaws and all, and this is me. Also like to hear I'm a Leader, which is by Unlike Pluto. That's my two favorite songs. So I am a leader in my industry. So.
Thank you. Ashley, what was your favorite childhood toy?
Ooh, I think mine, it actually wasn't a toy, it was a video game, but Club Penguin and Vantage were my two favorites. I spent too much time on it.
Thank you. Okay, Valencia, if you had a private jet, what would you name it?
Ooh, I had a private jet. I'll probably name it Coleman something, so that's my last name. And I really meet my dad's the reason I'm in the games and everything he does support me. So I really wanted to name a jet after him.
No, okay. Ashley, are you a morning person or a night owl?
I'm definitely a night owl, but I can be a morning person when I need to.
You're lucky. I'm a night owl and I cannot be a morning person. Valencia, would you rather go skydiving or bungee jumping?
Bungee jumping because there's a cord, and so that cord brings some stability and safety. It could break, but there's no cord with skydiving. So yeah.
That's what everyone says. Okay, Ashley, if you could switch lives with any celebrity for a day, who would it be and why?
Ooh, great question. I feel like a celebrity I would want to switch lives with would be, okay, the immediate thought was Taylor Swift because who wouldn't want to see what a day in the life of that would be like? But she's my go-to. I probably would switch with just to see a glimpse of what that lifestyle is like. Yeah.
Hectic and stressful.
I can imagine.
All right. Yeah. That's it, but probably very fruitful. Okay. Thank you guys so much for playing that. Let me, pick your brains on those for just a quick second. So we are going to go ahead and hop into some questions. So for everyone that is logged in with us, please definitely drop questions for our speakers in the chat. I'll prioritize your questions over the ones that I have, but I do have some questions to kick us off. So you both kind of did this a little bit, but we're going to start with you just kind of detail your educational and career journey so far. You can start at whatever stage you want to. If you started in kindergarten, you can start there. And we'll start with Ashley this time.
Okay. For me, what made me get started was, I mentioned that I grew up loving games. So I only knew that I liked Club Penguin, Vantage, and Pixar movies, and that was really my grasp of something. I wanted to do something with those things. Because with animation, I love storytelling, being able to tell a story and make something, but I also couldn't draw. At least I told myself I couldn't draw. But what I could do was I could use Microsoft Paint, and then with Microsoft Paint, I can use vectors, and I can fill in every pixel to kind of get an image that I liked rather than traditional drawing. So I really like this idea about being able to use other tools, like technical tools, to make things. And then as I started learning more and more about computers and technology, I learned about things like inspect elements. So I could, for example, change a web page and make it my own. And then as I went through high school, I had access to one computer science class, and then also joined programs like NCWIT, Girls Who Code. And then they showed me a lot about how I could use technical skills in a lot of different applications. So in college, I decided to study computer science. And then also still wanted to stay in touch with art history and art in some form. But I knew that I wanted to get into making Pixar movies or making video games and things that were interactive and had stories to them. And in high school, in college, when I was in college, I got the opportunity to first work at W Games Boston. So again, that was the game that was on a mobile platform. So it was a little bit of learning about all the systems behind games that weren't just the visual aspects. So games still need things like databases and a lot of computer components to run. And I started learning about how all of those tools work together to come make a game into one and to fuel how a game worked. But then that also just opened a lot of doors onto the other components of games. So the different types of teams and tech artists and roles that tie into it. So that got me really interested into tech art, which involved shading and lots of graphics. So eventually in college, I got more involved with the graphics community and started teaching the computer graphics class, and then just dove a lot deeper into the tools there. And then also worked at Disney Animation for a little bit because I loved being able to make those stories. And then went to a game startup after that to also work on backends for games at an earlier stage when they aren't fully developed. But those kind of things all happened one after another as I finished and continued my passion for just making things and creating games, really.
Thank you. Okay. Valencia, would you like to share your journey?
Yes, I love to share my journey. My journey started with me being a six-year-old child, and I sit there and play the game, old game called Jampire, and I love the storytelling, I love the characters, love everything about it. Then I played the game called Halo, and I loved everything about it. And so six-year-old me just walked up to my dad and be like, "Hey, Dad, I want to make video games for a living." And that man believed me. And he was like, "Cool. So we're going to keep playing video games." He got me. When at school, I would always talk about the games I played. He bought me a Assassin's Creed series. He was very supportive about being in the game industry. We would watch E3 together. We watched gaming conferences together. He said, "These are developers talking." So my dad very much improved of me being surrounded by game developers. And I was coming to college. I'm like, "Hey, Dad, I'm 18-year-old Valencia. I want to go to college for games." And he's like, "Okay, find a way to do that that makes money. Because I know you want to do storytelling, but storytelling and writing is not the quickest way to get into, you know, making money for it." So I was like, he told me, go Google. And I Googled and it says, "Hey, the easy way to get into games is to be a computer scientist." And I was like, "I hope I'm good at computer science." Told my dad I want to be a computer scientist. When I looked around, we found that a local school nearby me had a computer science program with a focus in game programming. And I started doing that and found out I was good at computer science and was really passionate about being a computer scientist. So I discovered NCWIT, discovered being other women in games in computer science, because there was barely any in my little small town and in my small college. There was barely any women in games, especially in games. So I started doing that, and then I graduated in 2020 with my bachelor's in computer science, certificate in web development, and a minor in business. So everything I need to start my own game studio if I wanted to. And 2020, I worked at an IT job because, of course, no game companies are really hiring at the time. So I worked at an IT job, had some basic experience. But when I was working IT, I was still making games on the side. I went back, and I would make visual novels. I would go talk to people. I did sell mentorships with the IGJ Foundation, ended up becoming a coordinator for them. Then I become an alumni coordinator for the IGA Foundations, getting involved at Black in Gaming, doing all these online things. And one time I was doing Xbox Game Camp, and my Xbox Game Camp man is like, "Hey, Valencia, so why are you not like applying to game jobs?" I was like, "Oh, I don't feel like I'm ready yet, because I'm not ready yet. I'm not ready yet. I can't get into the game industry. I'm not ready." And she was like, Girl, you have 7 games on itch.io. Yes, they're game demos, but they're playable. You better go apply for some gaming jobs. And so I went to several online conferences. I went to the Game Dev Colors, ended up talking to Bungie and went well. And then I got sad I didn't get the interview. Talked to recruiter and everything went well and then I didn't get the interview. I was very sad about it. And then I just randomly applied to some other game studio. It was called Alchemy Labs. And they called me one day and said, hey, I like your resume. You want an interview? And I was like, sure. And the rest is history. Now I work at Alchemy Labs as a game engineer.
Thank you. You are definitely a storyteller. I love
yes,
that.
Yes, I am.
Okay, so I want both of you, let's go deep. Let's go deep. So I made the joke earlier, y'all, that whenever I do these webinars, I feel like I am a talk show host. So that's my talk show voice. Can you both tell me what are some of the challenges you faced along your education and career journey? Let's start with Ashley.
Yeah, I think for me to start, in high school, I didn't have a lot of friends who were interested in computer science at first. So being in high school, I was often the only one that would go to game jams or hackathons or like kind of like put myself out there to learn more about computer science because we didn't really have the resources in my high school except for one class. So that was the first hard thing. And I think being able to just find that community over time was really important to me. So I joined things like Girls Who Code, NCWIT, and then in college, the Society of Women Engineers. And then they gave me a lot of the community that I didn't have growing up in high school to start. But I think the other thing that I struggled with a lot, two things. So one was imposter syndrome. I don't know if anyone's heard of imposter syndrome, but the way that I like to describe it is self-doubting yourself often as you're advancing in your career journey or educational journey. And then oftentimes I would just doubt whether I could even get through the classes that I needed to do the things that I wanted. And a lot of times I was like, I don't know if I can make it through. I would just self-doubt a lot, but having that community to fall back on was really important to help me still feel encouraged and know that I can get through, especially seeing other role models within games who are either game developers or creators of their own studios that I could look up to and follow. But then the other thing was technical skill wise, I wasn't the best in math. I was terrified of majoring in computer science because math was not my greatest skill in my educational realm. I struggled with it in high school at points. And I think in games and graphics, you think math is really important because it is, because you rely on physics, because you're simulating a lot of the real world. And you need math to make those things come to life virtually and digitally. But I think like over time, honing in on my math skills, not giving up on it, but then also realizing that I don't need to be the best at physics. I just know how to use certain skills was the most important thing. So for example, in computer graphics, you're doing a lot of things like simulating lighting, simulating how light is bouncing and the physics of those things, but that math is already figured out. You kind of just have to program it. And then that's something that I realized later on going into the realm of games and graphics, and it helped me become a lot more comfortable with myself and with how I could apply math and physics together to make these spaces happen. But those are probably the main ones that I can think of right now.
Yeah, I was really hoping you were going to share about the math, because I think that math is often used as like a barrier for computer science. And there are other ways that you can be a part of this industry and be, you know, a creator in this industry. I think that, like you said, you don't have to be able to be Einstein. I can't even think of any math equation past like the quadratic formula. Okay, Valencia, let's move to you. What about you? Can you share just maybe a couple of challenges you've faced along the way in your education and career journey?
Of course, I have plenty. One of the challenges I faced was growing up, I lived in a small town. I did not have access to computer science classes, let alone game programming, let alone like meeting other people that want to be interested in it. So counseling on Ashley, I was like, I was the only one. And for me, it was especially hurtful because I was the only woman of color in my area as well. So it was just very much like, what are you doing? what are you doing this for? And I felt like very much like I was isolated. And that was very hard and tough for me. And then I had communities like EBSCO, communities like NCWIT and Black and Gaming and IGJ Foundation, made me feel like I had more of a community backing. And like actually imposter was a big thing that I had to deal with as well. Remember when I, in my earlier backstory, my Xbox mentor was all like, you have games that are published. And I said, that's cool, but I still don't feel like I'm good enough. I just don't feel like I'm good enough. I applied to game development companies scared. I'm like, my portfolio is not good enough. It's not this, it's not that, it's not this, it's not that. And my mentors had to be like, doesn't matter. Can you do at least 70 to 60% of the job description? And I was like, yeah, then apply. Because there's male counterparts in your field who don't match everything either, and they're applying. And I had to really overcome that being scared to apply because I felt like I wasn't good enough, or I felt I wasn't this and I wasn't that. And another thing that also I dealt with, just going back to being the only woman in the room, I never really saw people in the industry. I followed all these game developers all my life. I followed all these people all my life, and none of them looked like me. Not a single one of them looked like me. And so I would go to schools and teach computer science. That's why I used to do volunteering work. And all the girls that looked like me will be like, I can't do what you do because no one out there looks like me. And it makes me feel like I'm the only one. And I know that feeling because I was. And so from then on, I felt that was a challenge. But now I'm like super passionate about being a role model for more women in games, being more of a female in color in games. So yeah, those were some challenges I faced. And that's how I overcome some of them.
Thank you both for your transparency. And yeah, imposter syndrome definitely gets the best of us. I think it's so interesting how across the board, it comes up in all of these webinars, you know, just that feeling of not being good enough yet and needing to work a little bit harder. Meanwhile, people who aren't, you know, marginalized by their gender per se, maybe are just like, yep, sign me up. I can only do like one of these things, but I'll do that one thing. So I'm glad you both were able to overcome that. Okay. So I think, let's say, how does your field affect or impact your identity and your perception of yourself and vice versa? I'm going to flip it this time, and Valencia, we'll start with you.
I'm a storyteller. So it might be a little, I'll try not to be too long-winded. So my identity and my career is very close together because I feel like in this industry, in the game industry, I have one industry I can be myself. As someone who went through like IT and corporate America for like 2.5 years to 3, not even that long, I absolutely hated it because I could not be myself. My hair that now is red. Last week it was blue, and I used to have crazy colors, and I wanted all these crazy things to just express myself. And I was just so looked down upon in my corporate America setting. It was like, don't do that. Don't do this. What are you doing? I used to come to work with my anime bag and get nasty looks. And I was all like, I just want to be myself. So that's why I decided, okay, I need to get into a creative field because this is not helping me. This is making me feel bad. This is making me feel awful because I can't be myself. I'm trying to conform to a corporate standard that I'm just not like. And so when I got into the game industry, and I remember the first time when I got my interview in the game industry, I got my job interview, I asked the person who gave me the offer, like, can I dye my hair, you know? And she's like, of course. Why would you start dyeing your hair? What does dyeing your hair got to do with your job? And it felt so relieving because I've been raised to always be like corporate America. And I was like, oh my gosh, I can be myself. And I can like just wear what you want to work. Oh, Mo, go wear your anime shirts to work. Who cares? And I was like, oh my gosh, thank you. Like, to me, the reason why I love this industry so much because I can be myself. I can be expressive. I can share in my little off-topic slacks. I share my pictures of my cosplay and everyone loves it. And it makes me be open, be myself. And a lot of the communities I am also let me be that. So I love being in the gaming industry because I feel like I can be fully identified as who I am.
I love that. Ashley, what about you?
I think for me, I do love the entertainment games industry. On a bigger picture of like the tech industry as a whole. I used to work in big tech when I first started interning, and I think there was it was a lot harder. I will say with things like big tech and working in a more standard technical role, there are things like higher pay and the ability to like work up that type of corporate ladder. But I remember like one of the memories I have as an intern at a big tech company was my manager would always make me cry just because they'd be very on top of like deliverables. And I also just didn't feel very close to the products that we were making. But when I went into games, I loved being able to actually work on things that felt relatable to me. I think the one thing with games that was hard though sometimes for me was I love games, but I wouldn't call myself a gamer. Like I don't go home and spend like 8 to 10 hours playing games after work as much as some of my coworkers did. And I think sometimes that made me feel like an imposter doing my own role sometimes, or like working in the game space, because I do love games, but I'm more of a hobbyist with it. Like I love mobile games. I like playing them in my free time, but like not dedicating hours and hours on it. And that's also why I really liked the animation industry too, because I really mainly just liked the idea of having art and storytelling and music and like creating this new environment that someone can be in for any amount of time. And I think in the past, games has had a culture that has been known to be very furry. For example, companies like Blizzard haven't had the greatest rep over the past few and over the past years because of things that have come up. But I think the studios that I've been at have always been super warm and welcoming. And I think within games especially, a lot of companies know of the past struggles that have been going on and are working to get rid of that environment and create a very welcoming space for a company environment that like represents the gamers that they're making games for. And I think that is huge and why I especially love being a part of the industry now when a lot of things are changing for the better. But I have had coworkers in the past sometimes, like I've had some coworkers be or like kind of question how I've gotten roles sometimes, or not how I've gotten roles, but have like said some questionable things in the past about like being a woman in technology within games, or not just in games but in technology as a whole. And I think when things like that happen, it can be very uncomfortable. I'm sorry, I'm being very vague about it, but I think like getting it out of my specific memory is difficult, but things like that happen where you can't underestimate yourself very easily in certain circumstances. But I think as a whole, the industry is getting a lot better at knowing those things and improving upon it.
Thank you. You both shared a lot. Thank you for being so transparent and vulnerable. And you gave me a perfect segue for a quick commercial break. Let's see if I can share my screen again. We are going to talk about the Aspirations in Computing community, which both of you spoke about the need to have aspiration or have community, right? To have be able to bring yourselves, how important it is to have people who are also kind of doing the same things as you that you can bounce ideas off of or learn from, et cetera. So one of the things that I like to highlight on this webinar series in particular is the Aspirations in Computing program and community, just because if you are not already a member, you should join Tootsuite. That means right now. So Aspirations in Computing is for women, genderqueer, and non-binary people in technology. There are a number of entryways. So whether you're in K-12, whether you are in higher education or in the workforce, there are ways for you to get involved with the community. To get involved with the program has two main components, the community and the awards, which we'll talk about both of those. And one of my favorite things about NCWIT is because we are a higher education program, everything's actually research-based, evidence-backed, and Aspirations in Computing is proven to enable long-term persistence through going, building a educational and career pathway in some of these industries, especially when you're facing the issues that Ashley and Valencia have shared and that are very common across these industries. So there are nearly 30,000 women in the AIC, women, genderqueer, and non-binary members in the AIC community. And I think that one of the big pieces too is 50% also identify as non-white, so otherwise known as people of color. And that speaks to what Valencia was sharing about, you know, she might go in there and she might still be the only person that looks like her. And so that makes this community, I think, pretty special. So with the AIC community, you can offer, first and foremost, community and connection over private digital spaces. So there is a Slack workspace, there's a private Facebook group, there is a LinkedIn group. And the topics range from job search advice to mental health discussion, interest groups. There's probably an anime group in there or cosplay group. It's just an opportunity for you to build community with people who are doing the same things that you're doing, kind of experiencing the same things that you're experiencing, but have a different perspective. And so I have a little quote from community member and campus rep who said, Sarah Olson, and she said, "I can guarantee I would not feel as capable of taking risks or questions without being constantly connected to all of these amazing community members." And that's really important because, like both of these speakers have mentioned, the imposter syndrome is real, especially when you are one of very few doing what you're doing. And even though you may have the passion, some of these challenges and barriers, they do feel a little isolating. So that's one of the wonderful things about this community. Some of the components or aspects are gaining skills and experiences through AIC labs and events. There are opportunities to meet your peers and colleagues, workforce members. We all know that social capital is, you know, key. It is king. You really do make it based not only on who you know, but there is a lot of opportunity to be found in building connections and bridging those spaces. So this is one way to do that. And then if you are in higher education, you could connect with other members in your college or in college across the United States through the AIC Campus Reps program. There are also other offerings. So we being Aspirations in Computing, you can receive funds. They will give you money to host an event through AIC meetups. You can apply for tech jobs through the AIC Career Fair. One thing that I love about this is I always hear from people when they're going to career fairs about how long the lines are, how some people are more domineering and like they oftentimes don't even get the opportunity to speak directly with the employers. And not at this career fair, like the balance is so amazing and it's only open to Aspirations in Computing community people, which means that you are more, well, I guess, this part's not evidence-based, but I feel like I infer from this that you're more likely to be able to talk to an employer, to pick their brains, to learn about that internship. And then we're also featuring our NCWIT Workforce Alliance partners who are the folks that are the companies that are recognizing that there is a need for diversity in their spaces. And so they are excited to bring on people who bring unique opinions and perspectives into their roles. The Aspirations in Computing program also has an amazing awards program. So there's high school awards, collegiate awards, and also an impact award. And then we do national social media campaigns. You can share your story. That this is one conduit or one avenue where we hear from Aspirations in Computing members, but there are other ways to get involved and share your experiences as well. So I already mentioned the awards. Ooh, somebody in the chat tell me if the Impact Award is still open. I think it maybe is, or it might be closing soon. But
it just closed yesterday.
It just closed yesterday. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Valencia. Mm-hmm. So I'll just go ahead and glaze past this really quick. But for next year, if you are being a person who creates computing experiences, say you run a coding camp for your church, or you do an after school, you know, mentoring of a robotics program, whatever, apply for this award and share what you're doing with us, because we have an award for that. And last but not least, if I have not convinced you, slide in my messages and we can talk more. Otherwise, you probably just want to scan this QR code and go ahead and get involved with the AIC community right now, because I know I'm an excellent salesperson. But really, I can't overemphasize like the importance of having these types of communities in these spaces, whether it's getting negotiating advice, because when you are doing your internships and you're, well, I don't know if you can negotiate for an internship, but when you're getting your jobs and you are getting your salaries, negotiate. And you could bring it to the AIC community and get some advice for it. If you're looking for a job, you could bring it to the AIC community and share. And whether it's, you know, get feedback on your resume, there are resume reviews, or hear from someone that's like, oh, my team is looking for this. So definitely a phenomenal program to get involved with. And now back to our programming. Let me go to my little...
Just to let you know, I was an NCWIT Impact Award winner last year. So yay, you get to the one of them.
Yeah, and both Valencia and Ashley are members of the Aspirations in Computing community. Mm-hmm. And so let's bring back the programming with that. Talk to me about your AIC kind of experience and any ways that you feel like has impacted your journey so far. And we can start with Valencia.
Hi, so I've been with AIC since I was in high school, and now I work in the workforce. It's been a long journey with them, and I absolutely adore being part of AIC. It was the first program I joined in high school. Again, I didn't have a computer science program in high school, so I was like, I just need other people who also like computer science, who all would be great. There are women, and it worked out. And so I did the high school award, and I didn't get it, but I did end up doing the collegiate award. I became finalist 2 years in a row. I also got the Impact Award last year. I have also did NCWIT. I was NCWIT like grant, where I used the grant money to help fund one of my events at my undergrad. I went to Girls Inc. to help them teach computer science. So I've been with NCWIT for a good minute, and they have really impacted my career. A lot of things I did was because of the funding that I got with NCWIT. And also I got my first mentee through NCWIT as well. So a lot of things I do now started with NCWIT.
And Valencia is doing this whole conversation, like our pre-conversation, our tech check. She is doing out there doing the thing. She's like, oh, I have another call after this. I'm going to be hosting a conference next week. I, you know, am finishing my master's tomorrow, like all of the things. So I love to hear that and see that. Ashley, what about you? Will you share your aspirations journey with us?
Yeah, I will say NCWIT single-handedly changed my life too. I started out in high school as well, and I was part of the high school awardees, and then with that I actually got the chance to start up my own program as well, because NCWIT had funding opportunities to start your own programs or workshops. So then from that, I started in high school, I knew I wanted to start a program to teach kids in my community about CS, since we didn't have any resources available in my town except for ones in high school once you're a junior or a senior. So I ended up getting a total of $15,000 from NCWIT in partnership with another nonprofit, and then was able to run free summer camps in my area to teach kids about electrical engineering and CS and just building circuits and building websites. And that was honestly some of the best times that I've had And it's been incredible seeing those kids now go to college and study computer science. And then that also got my start within outreach in college. And I think it's just meant a lot being able to see all of those people and see the impact spread so wide. But then also I've met some of the most incredible people through NCWIT who continue to inspire me. So I have a friend on this call, actually. I think Sam Soto is on this call, and she's one of my besties through NCWIT and through so many other programs. And Kelly too. Oh my gosh, shout out to Kelly. That I've just met through programs like NCWIT, but NCWIT's truly been the linker to a lot of friends that I've made around the US, even outside of the US, who continue to inspire me and challenge what I'm doing and how I want to keep on growing. So this community is a really special one.
Thank you both for contributing to my promotion, my commercial. I love that. I love that y'all are both so involved with NCWIT. Okay, so I'm scrolling now through the chat and we have questions, y'all. Okay, the first one, it says, I hear people in CS recommend a CS degree with a concentration, i.e. machine learning, software engineering, etc., as opposed to a generalist CS degree. If I want to do game design, would CS, computer science, with a concentration in game dev or general knowledge in computer science be more helpful in your opinion? Let's say Ashley, because I know you did like animation or something, I remember from our conversation.
Yeah, I think it really depends on how you want to go with your career journey too. So if you want to go into a four-year program, for example, some universities have concentrations and some don't. So my school, unfortunately, didn't really have any specializations formally within CS. So I kind of sought out resources, like art history was one of the things that I wanted to do, since it was like adding the minor wasn't too stressful. It was about 4 to 5 classes within my entire 4-year program. And that just helped me learn more about different art styles and then storytelling over the years and centuries. But within actual animation and graphics work, a lot of the classes I had to either learn from clubs within my school or different outside art classes that didn't have a formal program. So that was a little bit more makeshift. And I kind of had to figure that out on my own. But I know some schools do offer those programs where you can have a concentration, but TLDR on it, I think having a concentration, if you know what you want to do, is really helpful, because general CS knowledge is really helpful, like learning systems, understanding how an operating system works, how databases work, all tie into games and computer technology in general. But I think going into game dev, especially if you know you want to go into gameplay engineering or a specific game dev type of role, is critical, because you don't really learn things like Unity in college or how to apply languages like Python or C++ into games or graphics unless you find those courses and take it on your own.
Lindsay, what about you?
If you do have a concentration, I highly recommend taking it, because especially if you want to be in games, especially when you want to be a game, because game has a very unique, special pipeline that's not really like any other thing, especially like the IT or software. I jumped between web design, machine learning, and web development and games. And eventually I ended up with games. That's what I truly wanted to do. But just remember, if you get a concentration in games, and you're still a computer science major, you can go get a job somewhere else and not be in games. You still know the basics of computer science, but having that concentration means you understand more of the pipeline and understand more of how the game engineering, how game engineering works. So it is, can be somewhat different than regular engineering. Also, if you do not have a concentration in your school, because not all schools have that, just do what I did and make every project game related. I would go to a professor and be like, hey, I know we're in machine learning, and we're in the AI class, I'm gonna make AI NPC, just letting you know. Like, I went to our professor's offices and just said, hey, just letting you know, I'm gonna make it into the video game. I'm gonna turn every project I can into a video game. So that's what I did.
Just to jump off of that, big, big plus one, and you really just have to advocate for yourself. And if you have a mission, just go full force with it.
Yes, advocate for yourself. Okay. So I could go two different ways here. I'm going to go keep it with a little bit with the technical. So where do you recommend someone with no experience to start for video games, like programs, coding languages, or softwares? This person will be starting college in the fall, so still in K-12.
Who do you want to go first?
Sorry, Ashley.
Okay. I think honestly, just building things or like learning how to build things. If you don't know if like this is, or games is something, games or computer science is something that you want to fully do yet, honestly, I'd say go on YouTube, search basic game tutorial for any game that you want to do. And usually they walk you through how to make a very simple game. There's lots of tutorials online, which is why I think now you don't even need a college degree really to get into games if that's what you fully want to do one day. But it does give you like the whole ability to understand past games with computer science degrees as well, which is nice. But like all of those resources are online. You can go on YouTube, find those tutorials, and it really shows you what those pipelines are like. I think that can also be a lot at once though. So depending on, for example, if you've done art things in the past or done things like Scratch programming in the past, I think that gives you a different starter template on what to start with. So if you've done Scratch, there's ways that you can kind of just keep on building games in Scratch, and then that can translate later on to Python. If you decide to take a computer science course in college, for example, a lot of classes actually start out with making a very basic game in Python sometimes. And I think you can kind of foreshadow or like preview that by seeing if that course content involves making a game at all. But you can kind of find these resources online right now, which is really, really nice. But yeah, also just check out to see if your college has any intro classes. And if not, maybe they have classes before it that you need, like prereqs that you have to take. And I think just kind of having a route in mind on where you want to get to be, or if you want to go more of an exploratory route, is really helpful to gauge on what you want to see and what type of things you want to build too. So for example, making VR/AR games versus a simple 2D game would go very different routes. But you can learn both of them in maybe like a 3 to 5 hour tutorial. It's just, you might not understand everything, but it'll show you how those things work.
Thank you. Valencia, anything to add?
Not much to add. Like Ashley said, I would just see why you want to be in games. If you really want to be in games, what part of gaming do you really like? For me, I really like the narrative, and I was really into programming. So I was like, okay, let me go make a text-based game in Twine. Those are two things I really like, and I can't do art. So let me go make a text-based game in Twine and in Python and these little smaller things. And once I started doing that, I realized I really liked being in the game industry. And that's when I decided to go into computer science. So I recommend, even if you have no experience, start, like I said, looking things online. I spent the summer I spent before going to my first CS class, my parents bought me a Python book, and I sat there and spent the whole entire time making a text-based game in Python. So doing that basic thing, seeing like, okay, I start school in the fall, what courses I'm taking. You can sometimes reach out to your professor. And I was just very bold and very passionate. So I reached out to the professor, like, what are we doing? And it worked out in my favor when I was able to get I kind of breezed through CS1 because I spent all summer working on Python already. So I suggest like getting a head start.
Oh my gosh. And speaking of head start, you got a head start on my next question. You both talked a little bit about but I just elaborate quickly though, because we're down to our last 9 minutes. This conversation has been so good. We have some questions. So, okay. What are good skills I can build up this summer? This is the summer after first year in college that you think will help get an internship next summer. And then as an add-on, how did you guys apply for internships? Like how many, when, and which ones? We'll start with Valencia this time.
All right. So I know how to game dev internship. I always had like a web dev internship, but what I can give you advice on is look at what studios are having internships next up. We have some internships. Look at what they ask for in the requirements and spend this summer focus on getting those requirements. Usually they'll say Unreal Engine or Unity, or they'll say like Python or C++. Be like, okay, I have a whole year to hone down my skills to show them I can do this, I can get this internship. And then go around and if you're brave enough, and I was, ask people, the recruiter, like, okay, I want this internship. Can I learn about this internship more? Sometimes they have panels and stuff like this talking about internship. So I would say go and look at the requirements and match those, spend your whole summer trying to match those requirements.
Okay, Ashley?
I think knowing the timelines for applications and when internships start appearing is also really important. So usually they start opening around August through October for CS internships, which feels super early, which is a lot, but you just honestly got to know when to apply. And those applications can get really stressful sometimes when you're applying too, but you just have to put yourself out there. We were talking about this a little earlier, but even if you don't fit all of the requirements, like you've never used Unity, you don't know how it works, just apply anyways. And I think what people especially want to see in interns is that you're passionate, you're curious, and that you can be taught. And I think that's the biggest thing. Within games and entertainment specifically, a lot of people just want to see your genuine passion, like be able to tell a story on why you want to get into this industry, what you've done to build those skills up. But also having a portfolio is also really key, especially within technical art and game dev, just having a background of making games in the first place. Honestly, a lot of CS students don't normally do projects outside of what's done in school. So making that and putting it on your resume and being able to describe it well is key in order to make a whole picture of yourself. I think, so I started interning in big tech, but then it switched over to the entertainment industry. And then I think I would often apply to over 50 to 100 internship applications in one season. A lot of it is advocating for yourself. And then with that, I'll also say cold emailing works, and like cold LinkedIning people also works. And I think something special about games and entertainment is that everyone's very, very passionate. So if you slide into someone's inbox, they want to help you out because they've been there. They know what the grind is like, and that you love games and they want to help you get there. You just really got to put yourself out there. And then sometimes when that works out, the person who you're cold emailing might be your mentor one day in a corporate or like work environment. And that's something really special too. So just honestly put yourself out there. There's nothing to lose except for hearing a no or a no response back.
Thank you for saying that, both of you, talking about being brave and just putting yourself out there. There is an NCWIT resource that I will email after this webinar. Top 10 ways successful technical women increase their visibility. And it is available on NCWIT.org. The link is not working right now, but I will, like I mentioned, email it after this webinar. And it can give you some more tips for ways that you can increase your visibility, put yourself out there, and go out there and build your career. Okay, so we're getting down to the wire. So I'm going to do my closing question, which is, I want you to think back to baby you, however you define that, right? Literally, figuratively, whatever. What is one piece of advice or aspiration or something that you would tell baby you to get to where you are? And I'll let you breathe. And while you're thinking, I will go ahead and do our final poll. Just as a reminder, if you want to be entered into the participation drawing, you do have to participate in the polls. And so this is just going to be a closing poll. I'm launching it now. And any answer, I will not share the answers. And yeah, we'll start with Valencia. Just because we already heard about six-year-old Valencia, I want to hear, what does baby you get from you?
So if I went back in the past and told baby me what to do, I will say, hey, baby Valencia, hello, six-year-old springy child that won't stop bothering her father. I will tell her, like, don't be afraid to be yourself, because as soon as you start changing yourself and your identity to conform to whatever thing that needs to conform to, because you feel like, gotta conform, be successful. Yeah, you do do code switching, but you can still, someone out there, some company out there still gonna like you for you. And that's where I'm at now. My company currently likes me for me. I can still feel expressive. I can still be myself. There, you don't have to change yourself completely as a person. You can still be somewhat expressive at work as well.
I love that. Ashley, what does baby Ashley get?
Ooh, okay. I'm going to cheat, and I have three things I'd tell myself. So one is stay curious, keep on exploring everything. Don't forget your why, on why you started and where you want to go with it. And then also, when you're stressed, when you're sad, when you're angry, make things and use that to fuel everything that you make.
I love that. I like that. Okay. So I'm going to close us out now. Thank you both so much for giving your time, sharing your experiences. Thank you everyone for joining us and participating, giving questions for our panelists. I think that, tell me if I'm wrong, but both of them are open to connecting on LinkedIn and continuing the conversation. And so if you have further questions, you want to talk, definitely reach out to them via LinkedIn. And if you have not joined the Aspirations in Computing community yet, again, just want to emphasize that you want to join this community and just have this network in your back pocket. Finally, please help us improve this series. We have a little QR code for the survey. It'll also be emailed out to you at the end after this webinar. And I would really love to hear your feedback as we continue just growing into what's programs and creating opportunities for you all to learn and grow from each other. With that, we can cut out a couple minutes early. So thank you all so much for joining us, and we will catch you next time.